Hi, I'm Bill Simpson. I'm the collections manager of fossil vertebrates at the Field Museum in Chicago. Like so many of you, I'm isolating at home. Once a week, I get to go into the museum and do a walkthrough of our collection ranges just to make sure the collections are okay. But I can tell you, it's a very odd and lonely place, and we're all looking forward to getting back to our normal schedules and reopening the museum. But in the meantime, we've gotten some questions submitted, and I'd like to go through these and sort of interact with all of you this way. First question, how are complete skeletons held together? My gut says drills and screws, but that seems like a big risk when working with something so valuable. So what we're talking about here is the mounting of skeletons into a lifelike pose for exhibit in a museum. The mounting techniques have changed a lot over the years, but let me use a more modern mount to describe how it's done now. We have, of course, Sue, our large Tyrannosaurus rex, and that was mounted in such a way that each bone can come off the mount to be studied. It's not just an exhibit, of course, it's also an important research specimen, and people come from all over the world, paleontologists from all over the world, to study it. And if part of the mounting armature, which is holding it in place, is in the way of study, then we have set screws, and we can remove those tangs of metal that are holding it in place, and then take the bone off the mount and study it away from the mount. This is obviously a very expensive way of doing it. However, it protects the bone. There are no holes drilled in the bone. There's padding between the armature and the bone, and it allows us access to each bone. All right, second question. My five-year-old has been watching Dino Dana lately and wants to know if it's true dinosaurs are close relatives of birds. She won't believe me. Well, this is actually a pretty old idea that birds are dinosaurs, but it fell out of favor for a long time and was resurrected by a paleontologist named John Ostrom at Yale back in the late 60s. He gathered enough evidence that by this time it's an accepted fact that every bird that has ever lived is a dinosaur. They're not just related to dinosaurs, they actually are dinosaurs. Which means that the big dinosaur extinction back 66 million years ago really only took out the non-flying dinosaurs. There are still over 10,000 dinosaurs alive today, and when you sit down at your Thanksgiving dinner, you're eating a dinosaur. That turkey is every bit a dinosaur as any other dinosaur. Third question. A couple, I think, of Sue's teeth appear to be broken off. Did that happen in life or after death? So it happened during life. It seems odd to us because as mammals, we have two generations of teeth, our baby teeth and our adult teeth, and then that's it. If we take good care of our teeth, we have them for our whole lives. Reptiles do it a completely different way. They wear out their teeth and replace them throughout their lives, and Sue was no different. We think that tyrannosaurs, like Sue, replace their teeth about every 2 years. And so even though Sue is probably the oldest T-Rex known, it still has baby teeth erupting to replace teeth that were either broken or simply lost. Is it true some dinosaurs had feathers? Yes, absolutely. We've already discussed how every bird that's ever lived is a dinosaur, so those are all feathered dinosaurs. But there are many, many non-bird dinosaurs which also had feathers. Feathers, obviously, are soft tissue, and so they're generally not fossilized. So for the vast majority of dinosaurs, we don't know if they had feathers or not. But there are cases of exceptional preservation. The Germans have a word for this, Lagerstätte. And one of the most famous is in northeast China, in Liaoning province. And there you get not only flying dinosaurs with feathers, but also non-flying dinosaurs, hundreds of different beautifully complete skeletons with feathers. So yes, it's true. Dinosaurs did have feathers. We don't know how many dinosaurs, which ones had feathers, because feathers are so rarely preserved. Were there any bigger mammals in the age of dinosaurs as far as we know? Or were they really all small rodent-like creatures, as I've seen depicted? Well, this takes us back to Liaoning. Those same deposits preserve a cat or almost badger-sized mammal, Repenomamus. This is an interesting primitive archaic mammal called a triconodont. It was carnivorous. In one case, it had the remains of a juvenile cetacosaur dinosaur in its mouth, and in another, its gut contents appear to preserve a juvenile cetacosaur. Cetacosaurs are a group of smaller dinosaurs related to the origin of horned dinosaurs. So while most Mesozoic mammals were very small, there were some that got up to the size of cats or so. Did dinosaurs get arthritis? Yes, as vertebrates, they have joints between their bones, and as these joints age, or if they get damaged, then they develop arthritis, which is really just a damaged joint. I can give a pretty interesting example of that. Again, our big T-Rex, Sue, is likely the oldest T-Rex known. And it has pathologies throughout the skeleton, including several really great examples of arthritis. In Sue's tail, there are two tail backbones, which should have a nice joint in between them. But that joint is completely buried by extra bone, which grew around and just fused up that joint. And in fact, there's a third bone called a chevron that hangs down between the two backbones. That's fused in with the mass as well. We've CT scanned this mass of three fused bones, and there's the joint embedded in all this extra bone inside. But yeah, that joint was completely immovable. So Sue, like so many others, like me, had arthritis during its lifetime. Finally, why is it the T is capitalized in Tyrannosaurus rex, but the R isn't? So we have adopted a convention started by a Swedish botanist named Linnaeus to name species with a binomial, which just means there's two words in the name. The first word is the genus, in this case, Tyrannosaurus. The second word is what's called the specific epithet, in this case, Rex. And you put the two together and you have a species name, Tyrannosaurus Rex. The convention is that all generic names are capitalized, but the specific epithet is never capitalized. So to confirm, to reiterate, for example, with humans, our species is Homo sapiens. The H is capitalized, the S in sapiens is not. So that's all the questions I have. Please keep them coming. It feels like we're still connected to all of you. And we're looking forward to isolation ending and reopening the museum and seeing lots of you back at the museum in Chicago. So I'll sign off now, but hope to see you soon. Bye-bye.